Hello, everybody, and welcome to Our Historical Heritage, a podcast dedicated to telling the stories of yesteryear, where we examine the event, the people involved, the technology, and the legacy. I'm your host, Travis Gordon, and this is episode number 7. And in this episode, we're going to be exploring the life and photography of a man known for his primarily night photography and for capturing the waning days of steam, primarily on the mighty Norfolk and Western Railway. It's no coincidence that this episode is being released on December 16th, as today would have been this gentleman's 109th birthday, in addition to it also being my 30th birthday. Today, we're going to be talking about the life and photography of the legendary Ogle Winston Link. Ogle Winston Link was born on December 16th, 1914. He was best known for his black and white photography and sound recordings of the last days of steam locomotive railroading on the Norfolk and Western in the late 1950s. As a commercial photographer, Link helped to establish rail photography as a hobby. He also pioneered the concept of night photography, producing several well-known examples that we'll cover as we progress through this episode. His early photography was created with a borrowed medium format autographic Kodak camera. By the time he was in high school, he had built his own photographic enlarger, and after completing high school, he attended the Polytechnic Institute of Brooklyn, receiving a degree in civil engineering. Before his graduation in 1937, he spoke at a banquet for the Institute's newspaper, where he served as a photo editor. An executive from Carl Bayor's public relations firm was present and was impressed by Link's speaking ability. He offered Link a job as a photographer. Link worked for Carl Bayor and Associates for 5 years, learning his trade on the job. He also adapted to the technique of making posed photographs look candid, as well as creatively emphasizing a point. On his first major assignment to photograph part of the state of Louisiana in the summer of 1937, he found himself in New Iberia, the location where Cecil B. DeMille's 1938 movie, The Buccaneer, about Jean Lafitte was being filmed. Here he met his future first wife, a former Miss Arklatex, now actress, model, and body double named Vonda Ogilvie, who stood in for lead actress Francisca Gall. They took a shine to one another, and later that year she posed for some of his photographs in the French Quarter of New Orleans. They eventually married in 1942, but later divorced in 1950. Some of Link's photographs from this time included an image of a man aiming a gun at a pig wearing a bulletproof vest, and one eventually known as What Is This Girl Selling? Or Girl on Ice, which was widely published in the United States and later featured in Life magazine as a classic publicity picture. According to Thomas Garver, a later assistant to Link, during his employment at Bayor's firm, Link clearly defined a point of view and developed working methods that were to shape his entire career. When World War II reached the United States, Link found himself unable to join the military due to mumps-induced hearing loss. He left Bayor's employ in 1942 to work for the Airborne Instruments Laboratory, part of Columbia University, drawing on his university degree and professional photographic experience. Link worked at the laboratory as both a project engineer and a photographer. The laboratory was then researching a device to enable aircraft to detect submerged submarines. His main responsibility was photographing the project for the United States government. In 1945, with the end of the war, Link's employment at the Airborne Instruments Laboratory ended. He was invited back to Bayor's employment, but instead opened his own photography studio in New York in 1946. Some of his clients included Goodrich, Alcoa, Texaco, and Ethel. While in Stanton, Virginia for an industrial photography job in 1955, Link's long-standing love of railroads became focused on the nearby Norfolk and Western Railway. N&W was the last major railroad to make the transition from steam to diesel power and had refined its use of steam locomotives, earning a reputation for precision transportation and also for having a fleet of some of the most modern coal-burning steam locomotives in the country. Link took his first night photograph of the road on January 21st, 1955 in Waynesboro, Virginia. On May 29th, 1955, the N&W announced its first conversion to diesel, and Link's work became a documentation of the end of the steam era. He returned to Virginia for approximately 20 visits to continue photographing the N&W. His last night shot was taken in 1959, and the last of all in 1960. That year, the road completed the transition to diesel, by which time he had accumulated 2,400 negatives on the project. Now, although it was entirely self-financed, Link's work was encouraged and facilitated by N&W officials, from President Robert H. Smith downwards. Besides the locomotives, he captured the people of the N&W performing their jobs on the railroad and in the trackside communities. Some of his images were of the massive Roanoke shops where the company had built and maintained many of its locomotives. Link's images were meticulously set up and posed, and he chose to take most of his railroad photographs at night. He said, "I can't move the sun, and it's always in the wrong place, and I can't even move the tracks, so I had to create my own environment through lighting." Although others, including Philip Hastings and Jim Shaughnessy, had photographed locomotives at night before, Link's vision required him to develop new techniques for flash photography of such large objects. For instance, the drive-in image, Hot Shot Eastbound, photographed on August 2, 1956, used 42 number 2 flash bulbs and one number 0 fired simultaneously. Link, with an assistant such as George Tom, had to lug all of his equipment into position and wire it up. This was done in series, so any failure would prevent a picture being taken. Taking night shots of moving trains in the right position for the subject could only be guessed at. Link used a 4x5 graphic view camera with black and white film, from which he produced silver gelatin prints. In addition to his black and white night shots, Link also recorded the single daytime train on the Norfolk and Western's Hilly Abingdon branch, serving the rural communities from Abingdon, Virginia, 55 miles south to West Jefferson, North Carolina. It was also on this line that most of his railroad color photography was done. In addition to photographing them, Link was also making sound recordings of the trains, which he issued on a set of 6 gramophone records between 1957 and 1977 under the overall title Sounds of Steam Railroading. In the railfan world, he was probably best known by these and by photographs published in Trains Magazine and elsewhere in the 1950s, which inspired others to follow his example. The recordings he made from 1957 to 1977 were inducted into the National Recording Registry in 2003. From 1960 until he retired in 1983, Link devoted himself to advertising. Among notable pictures taken during this period are those recording construction of the Verrazano Narrows Bridge, and other views of New York Harbor, including some of the great ocean liners. In retirement, Link moved to South Salem in Westchester County, New York. He made a cameo appearance as a steam locomotive engineer in the 1990 film October Sky, operating the Southern Railway No. 4501, which for the film was decorated to look like a Norfolk and Western locomotive. He was also actively involved with the planning of a museum of his work when he suffered a fatal heart attack near his home in South Salem. He was transported to Northern Westchester Hospital in Mount Kisco, New York, where he passed away on January 30, 2001. Link was interred adjacent to his parents in Elmwood Cemetery in Shepherdstown, Jefferson County, West Virginia. And with that, let's get into looking at some of his photographs. We'll talk just a little bit about each one and what we're seeing in the photograph as we go through it. The first Link photograph that we're going to look at is one of his most famous ones and probably one of my personal favorites, known as Hot Shot Eastbound. In this shot from a drive-in theater located in Yeager, West Virginia, we see articulated Class A 2664 number 1242 racing by with a manifest freight while moviegoers enjoy the 1955 war film Battle Taxi. While Link's main focus is often attributed to the train, this photo can also be considered a bit of a muse, combining three eras of what was then modern life: the steam-powered freight train, the teenage lovers that were posed in Link's 1952 Buick Super Convertible, and an image of the future, jet travel. The locomotive type in this photograph is what Link considered to be his ideal, stating that the Class A's were the most beautiful engines ever built. Link also had to use a process known as photomontage in development of this print, inserting the frame from the movie that was on screen at the moment of capture, as the flashes did drown out the movie screen. This photo you're seeing here, it was titled as Engineer of Train No. 2 Oils Up K2 No. 130. The Norfolk and Western had two primarily different streamlined locomotives on their roster. You had the famous Class J 484s and others that were known as Baby J's, which were the streamlined K2 Class 482 Mountains. In this shot, Link captured a worker, in this case No. 130's engineer, oiling around the locomotive prior to pulling away with northbound train No. 2. This shot which is another one of the more recognized ones that Link produced, was titled Maud Bows to the Virginia Creeper. In this shot, we see Maud the horse seemingly taking a bow to another horse, one made of iron. Photographed at Green Cove, Virginia, the train is running on the fabled Abingdon Branch behind M-Class 480 No. 382. The depot still survives today, and this branch is now a popular hiking and biking trail known as the Virginia Creeper Trail. Locomotive No. 382, of course, has been long scrapped, but operable twin No. 475 at the Strasburg Railroad has been altered cosmetically on more than one occasion to mimic her famously photographed sister. In Giant Oak at Max Meadows, Virginia, we see train number 17, the Birmingham Special, racing through Max Meadows behind a streamlined Class J steam locomotive. Notice the large volume of head-end cars, where most of the money on a passenger train was made. The giant oak tree in the foreground of this photo, while taking up the majority of the composition, also seems to illustrate time itself. More than likely, this tree was growing before the locomotive pulling the train was even built. And chances are it probably stood for many years after the engine was removed from service, and depending on the locomotive, if it was not locomotive 611, it would have been scrapped. In train number 2 through Lithia, Virginia, Link chose to focus his camera on the people sitting on the porch, carrying on a conversation and paying not a single heed to the thundering thoroughbred on the main line behind them. If I recall reading correctly, this was train number 2 and was more than likely being pulled by one of the streamlined K2 class mountain locomotives. It is said that you can't hear pictures, but if one were to imagine close enough, I believe that you could hear this one that Link captured at North Fork, West Virginia in 1956 as locomotive number 2197 thunders through town. The photo, titled Main Line on Main Street, illustrates this locomotive, which was one of 30 2882 compound Malays that were home-built in the company's Roanoke shops, and it was classified as a Y6B. This shot, titled Coaling Station, was made at the Schaefer's Crossing Engine Terminal in Roanoke, Virginia. Now, we see a lot going on here, as three locomotives occupy this December 12, 1955 photo. From the left is S1A Class 080 Switcher No. 243, built in 1953 as the next-to-last locomotive constructed at the Roanoke shops. On the next track over is Y6A Class 2882 No. 2143, and on the right is J Class 484 No. 608. Standing next to the 2143 is coaling tower operator Coleman Hairston on the left and hostler R.E. Hall on the right. In this shot from 1955, titled Filling Locomotive No. 104 with Sand, Link photographed a roundhouse worker in Bristol, Virginia, topping off the sand dome on K1 Class 482 No. 104, which was built in 1916 by the N&W at their Roanoke shops. In this famous shot, it's another one of those that you can hear if you imagine hard enough. In this busy shot, titled Hawksbill Creek Swimming Hole, we see several children playing in the swimming hole on Hawksbill Creek near Luray, Virginia, as Y6A No. 2145 thunders overhead on the big bridge. In this shot, titled Hester Fringer's Living Room on the Tracks, as seen in other pictures, Link loved to incorporate people into his shots. In this shot, captured on December 16, 1955, Mrs. Fringer's son is waving at a train behind one of the big streamlined engines of the N&W as it passes right outside the house. Meanwhile, Mrs. Fringer seems to have a bit of a stern look on her face, probably because she gets to see her son do this quite regularly, and she might be getting a little frustrated with his antics from time to time. In this shot from June 20th, 1955, titled Lubricating Locomotive 563, Link was inside the grease bay at Bluefield, West Virginia, as Dominic Girardi, takes a grease gun to the many moving parts of E2A Class 462 No. 563, which by now was 43 years old and relegated to local service on the Clinch Valley line between Bluefield and Norton, Virginia. In 1955, Link captured one of the massive Y6 locomotives as it thundered into Luray, Virginia, and this shot was simply titled as Luray Crossing. Link was captivated by the late era of the steam locomotive, and sensing its imminent demise, he set out to photograph not just the machines, but the people who operated and cared for these iron beasts. In this shot from 1958 at Roanoke, titled Class S1 Switching Locomotive 261 and Its Crew, he captured the crew of 080 Switching Locomotive No. 261 as they went about their business of building trains and sorting cars at the massive yards. Locomotive 261 was one of 30 080s purchased by the N&W from the Chesapeake and Ohio Railroad in 1950. In this shot, titled Ghost Train Passenger, Link was in Norfolk, Virginia in 1955, where he captured streamlined K2A Class 482 No. 125, leading what was listed as a Pullman Extra. I could not find any notes on how Link made the train appear as a ghost, but in my humble opinion, for whatever it might be worth, it definitely captures the foreboding that the end of the era that was quickly approaching kind of signaled to the railroad and the people that worked on it. In this shot, simply titled as Train 202 at Husk, North Carolina, shot in 1956, Link has returned to the Abingdon branch at Husk, North Carolina, where he captured double-headed train number 202 with a M-Class 480 leading as it passes by the old general store. And it is one of only a handful of known color photos that Link captured in his Norfolk and Western project. In this shot, made in 1956, titled Schaefer's Crossing Turntable, locomotive number 2143, a massive compound articulated engine, is seen being prepared to go for a spin on the turntable before heading off on another run, either that or heading into the shops for some general servicing. In the shot titled Kelowna Shipyards, locomotive number 606, a streamlined J-Class 484, is seen on the point of the Cavalier, which offered Pullman service in Bud-built, yet N&W-owned sleeping cars on its route between Norfolk and Cincinnati. And the train is seen passing by the Kelowna Shipyards near Norfolk, Virginia, in this photo. In Stanley, Virginia, Link captured patrolman Weldon Painter as the first section of train number 51 thunders through behind one of the big Y6 class 2882s in 1956. This shot, capturing small town America, was titled Officer Painter Patrols Main Street. In Solitude Siding in train number 2, captured in 1957, Link shot northbound train number 2 behind one of the streamlined K2A class 482s as it waits at Solitude Siding near Arcadia, Virginia, before continuing its trip north. Bridge number 322 at 7 Mile Ford, Virginia is the scene of this photo from 1957 titled Silent Night at 7 Mile Ford. Here we see a father and son taking home a Christmas tree that they've just cut down, yet stopping for just a moment to admire streamlined Class J number 611 as it blasts across the bridge, disappearing into the night just as quickly as it appears. In this photograph, titled Sometimes the Electricity Fails, we see a photo from Vesuvius, Virginia, where Link captures the frustration of the couple in the car and the determination of the gas station attendant trying to get the pump to work as streamlined K2A number 131 thunders by. The next few photographs are going to kind of differ from what we've been seeing thus far with the Link's photography. In this one, entitled Servicing EMD Diesel Electrics, which was another one of the rare color photographs that Link captured, we see something he even more rarely photographed, diesels. In this 1960 photo from Schaefer's Crossing in Roanoke, a pair of EMD GP9 diesels get serviced prior to their next run. In this 1951 photo, Link ventured away from the Norfolk and Western, heading back to Louisiana, and he also ventured away into daytime photography to capture this Southern Pacific train at Houma, Louisiana, behind oil-burning 280 No. 890, a C-24 class 280 consolidation owned by SP subsidiary Texas and New Orleans Railway as it crosses the intracoastal waterway with a local freight. This photo is simply titled Southern Pacific Local Freight Crossing the Intracoastal Waterway. In this 1933 photo titled The Blue Comet in Jersey City, Link is in, obviously, Jersey City, New Jersey, where he photographs Central Railroad of New Jersey number 831, a handsome 462 built for pulling the express passenger train known as the Blue Comet. And in this photograph titled Birmingham Special at Rural Retreat, we have reached the end of this episode. And so in this final photograph we're going to look at, we see station agent J.L. Akers waving a highball to the engineer of the Birmingham Special at Rural Retreat, Virginia, at 11:37 p.m. on December 24th, 1957. In just 3 short minutes, it would be Christmas Day, as this train thunders on into the night. On that same evening, Link also captured an audio recording of train number 42, the Pelican, behind another J-class locomotive, number 603, at the pretty much the exact same location. And to close out this episode of Our Historical Heritage, I've included the recording of train number 42 that he captured at Rural Retreat in its entire 9:43. Until next time, this is Travis Gordon, and thanks for tuning in to Our Historical Heritage.
Thank you.